Good evening, everybody. How's everybody doing? Everybody have a good meal, get things done? Thank you. Thank you, thank you. I haven't done anything yet. I'd like to thank everybody for coming. My name is Doug Parsons, and I'm the president of the board of directors of the American Banjo Museum. And I'd like to welcome you all here. Everybody's done a great job with our staff. I hope everybody's having a great time out here tonight. Give them a hand. So I got some housekeeping things to do. I want to introduce our board of directors that are here tonight. Lester Cowden. Lester from Oklahoma City, right there. Justin Givens from Oklahoma City with his lovely date, Josie. Hi, Josie. And we got Jack Murphy's also not here because he has COVID, unfortunately. So make sure to give him a kiss on your way out. He's at the elevator. Brian Newsom from Michigan. Debbie Schreier from Minnesota. Paul Poirier from Rhode Island in Seekonk, Massachusetts. Where you at, Paul? Oh, there you are. Alan Tompkins. Are you here, Alan? Did you make it? There he is, from Dallas, Texas. Alan's our newest board member, and we're really excited for him to join us. Me, I'm Doug Parsons. And we also got, yeah, you don't have to clap for me. All I did was miss a meeting, and they made me president. Never miss a meeting in a nonprofit. And we got Michael Mason, Jens Kruger, and Danny Rubio, who couldn't be with us tonight, but I think they're with us with the camera, so give them a round of applause. Too. I'd also like to thank the American Banjo Museum staff, who actually go out of their way, and they put so much work and so much effort into this weekend that all you see is the end result. You don't see everything that comes up to do with that, and they do an unbelievable job. Margie Smith Robbins, Lucas Ross, where's Lucas at? Lucas, where's he at? Oh, you got the good seats. Rachel Reichert, Ellie Burns, where's Ellie at? There she is. And our newest addition, Tyler Jackson, assistant curator. Stand up and let everybody see you. Tyler just joined us as the assistant curator and part of our transition of getting Johnny the heck out of here. But, oh, is he here? And speaking of Johnny, none of this at the museum or anything that we do would be possible without his leadership and his backbone and background and doing everything he does for the museum. Johnny Beyer, where's he at? Oh. Cheryl Mitchell, is Cheryl here tonight? I haven't seen Cheryl. Mm-hmm. And Donna Jennings, she's also a big help for us down there at the museum. And we got our American Banjo Museum volunteers, Eric Offsprung. Eric, you still here, aren't you? He's our bus guy tonight. There he is. Alma Cochran, Karen Lennox, and Bill Elliott, who's always there playing banjo for us. And I also like to introduce the past Hall of Fame members. Debbie Schreier, 2014. Debbie? Debbie's father, Lowell Schreier, is also in the Hall of Fame. I think you're the only father and daughter in the Hall of Fame. Speaking of that, Pat Terry Jr. from Florida. His father is also in the Hall of Fame, Pat Terry Sr. So we got the, well, anyways, it's my own little world. Scott Whitfield. I know I've seen Scott earlier. And of course, Johnny Beyer. And we also have a past Jack Canine winner, Margie Robbins. And Paul Poirier. Paul and Teresa Poirier. And have I missed anybody? I guess not. We also want to thank the musicians of Matt Beyer Quartet. That's Johnny's son, actually. Matt, congratulations. Now, last year with the COVID thing, everybody was kind of still antsy on things, and we did an award for somebody, and unfortunately they couldn't be there. But this year, this person has, for the last 5-6 years, has really gone out of their way to help the board, help the museum. She helps in every way she can. And we like to present, where'd it go?
Oh, took it away.
You took it away? I'd like to do an award of excellence for Ellie Burns. Come on up here, Ellie. Come on up here.
Help her up. Help her up.
Come on over here. I know you got a 4-hour speech in you. Come on up. Did you prepare your speech?
I didn't know it was going to happen.
You told us to do this.
Okay, I'm pretty good at off-the-cuff speeches. The same guy who brought Johnny here from Orlando called me one day and said, "Have I got a deal for you?" Well, I was out in my front yard. I didn't know what to say to him. He says, "Hey, our banjo museum needs a board of directors secretary, and you would be great." I said, "But I don't know how to play the banjo." And he said, "But you don't have to. We'll get you a recorder, put it in the middle of the table, and we'll pay you." Well, that didn't happen, but that's okay. And in these 12... But I said, every banjo player needs an audience. And here I am, right? So there are a lot of people in this room who have been an audience for this place for a long time, and we love it because I have met so many wonderful performers. And I don't know how you can be involved in an organization that is so wonderful and so wholesome. In today's world, don't we love wholesome? And genuine and honest and terrific. And I would not be anywhere except involved in this museum, but I sure didn't know this was gonna happen. So thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Ellie, that's well deserved. She really helps the board and she really does everything we ever ask of her. Thank you. Well, without further ado, I'd like to turn the podium over to Johnny Beyer, and we'll get the show started. Is there any questions, comments, concerns? Okay, here we go, Johnny Beyer.
Thank you very much. I feel good tonight. I'm really tired already, but it's always our annual love fest for the banjo when we get together. The year of COVID really made us realize how much we miss being with you all in person. So for you new folks, and I see a lot of new faces out there tonight, welcome. We are delighted to have you in our family, and we hope you have a wonderful evening. This is something we look forward to, sharing the heritage of the banjo, the variety of styles of the banjo, and you're going to see an awful lot of different styles tonight, and you're going to meet some wonderful musicians that, if you haven't seen them before, this is going to be a treat for you. Before we go on, I want to thank our sponsors. We could not be here tonight without our sponsors. Devin and Gail Tower. Devin was a board member for a long time, became an annual sponsor even when he's not on the board. Paul and Teresa Poirier, thank you so much. All your help and sponsorship. Roger and Ellie Burns, the trophy, we'll just add another 1,000 onto your sponsorship. Lester and Leanne Cowden, thank you guys. Yep. And we'd like to thank the Singleton family, a legacy here at the Banjo Museum. Alan Tompkins made it in. Thank you, Alan, our new board member. And then we have some businesses that actually think it's worth having a banjo museum in Oklahoma City, and so do we. We'd like to thank Bank First, the Bricktown Alliance, PBS Services, which is Doug's business, and the Oklahoma News Channel 4. Those of you who know Lucas Ross, you see him every morning as he daylights, or it's kind of moonlighting, isn't it? What is it? I don't know. He's got another job, let's put it that way. But they're a great sponsor for us and get the word out. And we've got GraphTech Communications, who did all the printing. They print our newsletters and our wonderful program you see in front of you, the Oklahoma City CVB, and Perry Dunn Attorneys. Thank you, Justin Givens, for having your firm be part of the museum in your support. And I don't mean that just financially. It's great to have a legal mind to tell us when we're about to screw up. We have some special guests we'd like to welcome from Arts Council OKC. Where are the Arts Council OKC people? Welcome to you all. And the Oklahoma City Community Foundation, we've got some friends from there. Welcome to you guys again. You know, the Oklahoma music community wouldn't be what it was or what it is without the contributions of Byron Berline and John Hickman. We lost both of them in the last year, and we'd like to welcome Betty Berline and Sue Hickman. Thank you for being here. We have musical guests over the weekend. If you're not familiar with these guys, you have seen them perform last night. You are going to see them perform tonight and tomorrow night at the Bricktown, tomorrow day at the Bricktown Banjo Bash and at our Pizza Parlor Sing-Along, you're going to meet some fabulous musicians from all over the country who make the banjo what it is. Tonight you'll be meeting Lincoln Hensley and Ainsley Porchak. Where are you guys? Right over here. In just a minute. You'll be meeting new Hall of Fame member Randy Morris and Pat Terry Jr. as musical guests tonight. Alan Mundy, our new Hall of Fame member, and his band with Bill Honker and Elliot Rogers. They'll be performing for you tonight. Also, as a kind of an added attraction, Debbie Schreier is going to be performing for you tonight. It's not in your program. This is salacious info we save only from the stage. And we have a surprise guest joining myself. Tyler Jackson and I are going to also perform. So if you're wondering what kind of music you're going to hear tonight, that's the variety, and we're looking forward to doing it for you. Now, very quickly, we are going to introduce our Hall of Fame inductees for this year. We've just done it to a degree, but Sonny Osborne, unfortunately, we wanted to induct Sonny during his lifetime, and in the election process, he breathed his last breath, and we miss him. But tonight, he will be represented by his handpicked protege again, Lincoln Hensley. Lincoln will be here tonight. And now, one of my favorite people in the world, great musician, Randy Morris is here as a new inductee. Say hello to Randy Morris. We'll ask Alan Mundy to stand up, if possible. Thank you, Alan. And you're also going to meet, and I'm sorry, guys, my eyes aren't what they used to be, but I missed in introducing Don Vappi and his band. Don is our new Hall of Fame inductee, and his band, Thomas Fisher and Elliot, and... hang it. He's the coolest cat in the world, trust me. And his band, Thomas Fisher and Richard Moten. They're here tonight, going to be performing as well. So, we're gonna give you a few minutes right now to recall the past. We can't go forward until we look where we've been. This would be a good opportunity if you need to do something. you can figure out what that is, and we'll start the Hall of Fame inductions in just a few minutes. But for right now, let's take a look at the almost 85 Hall of Fame members of the past. For those of you who are not banjo players, and I'm sure there are a few of you out there, there are different styles of banjo. And if you are a banjo player, you already know that the video you just saw up until 2014, let's get in the right century here, up until 2014, our Hall of Fame was exclusively honoring people who played and promoted and taught the four-string jazz age tenor and plectrum banjos. Our board of directors, led by Jack Canine, with a great stroke of wisdom, decided that we needed to embrace the entire banjo family. And that is what we've been doing since 2014. So if you're looking at this and saying, where are all the five-string players before 2014? That's the explanation. We apologize, but we're doing our best to go forward and to make up for lost time. And one of those lost time things that we try to do is honor the people that we needed to honor a little bit earlier, quite frankly. Sonny Osborne is one of those people. He has been on the top of our list as we play catch-up in the world of the five-string banjo and bluegrass. Sonny Osborne, his story will, if you don't know who he was, his story is legendary among musicians, and he was an innate musician, a great vocalist, and one of the most emulated and imitated, and I bet I'm going to say that in the beginning of the video anyway, banjo player in the world. So if you don't know or remember Sonny Osborne, let's take a look at his career.
Well, the sun came up bright and clear. I headed for the fishing hole. Just in case the fish don't bite, I brought along my old banjo.
Arguably one of the most listened to, imitated, and emulated banjo players in the history of bluegrass and country music, Sonny Osborne spent a lifetime honing a unique and milestone-setting musical style and professional career both long before and long after the bluegrass anthem Rocky Top thrust he and his brother Bobby into the national spotlight. While the Osborne brothers will forever be remembered for the once-in-a-world mix of stunning vocal harmonies and intuitive, masterful musicianship which redefined bluegrass music, Sonny Osborne hoped instead to simply be remembered as someone who made a difference. Roland Sonny Osborne was born in 1937 in Thousand Sticks, the Appalachian enclave near Hyden, Kentucky, where he and his brother Bobby and sister Louise spent their early years. After the family moved to Dayton, Ohio, Sonny took up the banjo at the age of 11 and was performing locally and recording with Bobby and Louise within just a few years. Formed in 1953, the first incarnation of the Osborne brothers was split up temporarily when Bobby went into the Marines, while Sonny, just out of his freshman year in high school, was hired by Bill Monroe to tour, record, and perform on the Grand Ole Opry. From his earliest recordings with Bill Monroe to now classic Osborne collaborations with Jimmy Martin and Red Allen, Sonny Osborne's ferocious and innovative banjo playing was recharacterizing the instrument's identity, while his flawless baritone voice, the perfect complement to brother Bobby's soaring tenor, established new and exciting standards for vocal harmonization in bluegrass and country music. Although the brothers had mastered their craft in West Virginia during a six-year tenure on the Wheeling Jamboree, they were still struggling financially. All that changed, however, in 1964, when through the tutelage of the Wilburn brothers, a career dream came true and the Osborne brothers were invited to become part of the Grand Ole Opry.
When it comes to good harmony, you'll never find anybody that'll beat the Osborne brothers.
Although an imaginary wall separated country and bluegrass music at the time, the Osborne brothers proved to be critical in breaking down that barrier. As an essentially bluegrass group performing in country music's most hallowed hall, it was Sonny Osborne who envisioned ways to commercialize the brothers' sound, introducing influences of rock and roll, rhythm and blues, modern country, pop, folk, and jazz into the band's already stylized approach to bluegrass. although it made purists uncomfortable, their amplification of what had typically been acoustic bluegrass instrumentation allowed the Osborne Brothers to headline alongside big country acts in mainstream venues, exposing bluegrass to a new audience while blazing a path for the up-and-coming artists of the Newgrass movement. After recording numerous bluegrass and country fan favorites for MGM and Decca Records, a milestone in the recording career of the Osborne Brothers occurred in 1967. In search of one more song to fill out a session, the brothers recorded a novelty tune which had been pitched to them by its writers, Felice and Bootlow Bryant. Harkening back to their mountain heritage, Rocky Top became a bona fide crossover hit, instantly making the Osborne Brothers national country music stars. After endearing itself to millions, including President Richard Nixon during the Osborne Brothers' first ever by a bluegrass band performance at the White House in 1973, through their recording and an incalculable number of performances of the song, in 1984, Rocky Top was named the official state song of Tennessee.
Rocky Top, Tennessee.
In the 1990s, the Osborne Brothers made an ingenious reverse innovation, returning to their bluegrass and acoustic roots, a move which helped the fledgling bluegrass festival scene explode as a new and viable performance marketplace for struggling bluegrass musicians. The crowd-pleasing music and onstage antics, which further connected Sonny and the Osborne Brothers with their audiences and fans, continued until the early 2000s, when health issues forced Sonny to retire from performing. He nevertheless remained active in bluegrass circles by promoting his own line of banjos, as well as writing Ask Sonny Anything, a regular column for Bluegrass Today that brimmed with the same energy and wit that he once had flashed on stage. Sonny Osborne once described a person's success in any field of endeavor by them having made a difference through innate and groundbreaking musical and professional innovations, spurred as much by survival as well as artistic creativity. Sonny Osborne did make a difference for the better in the sound and perception of both the banjo and bluegrass music itself, and was, both by his own definition, as well as that of the thousands of bluegrass fans and musicians who have considered him an inspiration for decades, a great success.
Banjo's going home. Banjo's going home. Banjo's tired of roaming. Banjo's going home.
Hi, everyone. This is Bobby Osborne. And I want to speak to you a second here about my brother and me started a long time ago together as Osborne Brothers. And as far as banjo playing goes, I don't think that anyone could play and do what he did on the banjo as well as he did. So a lot of banjo players is great out there, but Sonny had a style of his own. And I surrounded so many years, I thought he was the best.
When banjo players get to a certain age, they want to make sure that their legacy continues musically. And Sonny Osborne took a shine to this young man, and protege is about the best word we can use, but he is a wonderful player, a fun guy to be around, and he loves bugging Greg Rich as much as I do. So please welcome, as they pay tribute to Sonny Osborne, Lincoln Hensley and Ashley Porchak. Ainsley Porchak.
Thank you for that. Check one. Thank you for that nice build-up, Johnny. It's just like I wrote it. I'm gonna do a tune that Sonny wrote back in the late 70s. And one of the things that drew me to Sonny's playing early on was that he wasn't so focused on playing incredibly fast banjo instrumentals. Being the only other fill instrument in the band, his brother was singing lead most of the time, and he got put into fills on slower songs, and so he quickly started learning pedal steel and piano licks, and transcribing them over to the banjo. And this tune uses a little bit of both. It's a tune called Dandelion.
Lincoln, I believe this statue is heavier than you are, so I want you to hold it. Just try it.
Well, it's about equal to the banjo.
We'll put it up here.
Will it stay there? Will you trust your podium?
Yeah. Excepting for Sonny Osborne and his wife, Judy, Lincoln Hensley.
Thank you all so much. I'm not a very good public speaker, so you'll just have to bear with me. But it was a great, great honor to get to be a student of Sonny's, because he didn't really do that. He didn't teach lessons or anything like that. And he, those that knew Sonny, he had a little bit of a temperament, and he always told me he wasn't a good teacher because of his short temperament with me. And I've been called every name in the book, and he even created some new ones for me when I would forget something or play something wrong. But it was great to be one of his students. And Sonny was a very forward-thinking person, and he knew the end was near, and opportunities like this may arise that someone would ask to be speaking on his behalf. So he actually gave me his acceptance speech that he would want me to use for any award he had won. And it looks like it's gonna be an interesting one. I don't deserve this, but I had arthritis and I didn't deserve it neither. And that is the end of the acceptance speech. But I've written a few things down that I think should be mentioned about his career, because he accomplished so much in a lifetime that I wanted to write it down, because there's a lot of the stuff I would have forgotten. He was the first bluegrass band, he and his brother, the first bluegrass band to go electric, which they received mixed reviews on, but they certainly brought a whole new audience into bluegrass. They were the first and only vocal group to win CMA Vocal Group of the Year. The first time that's ever been done by a bluegrass band. And they did that in 1971. They were the first bluegrass group to have twin Scruggs-style banjos on a record. They did that in 1956 with their first record deal with Ruby. He was the first guy to write a Scruggs-style banjo book on how to play the banjo, even before Earl. And he took it to Earl once he got it done and tried to give it to him because he felt like Earl should have the first say-so on it. And Earl's wife quickly spoke up and said, "We've determined his style can't be written down." And after the first few thousand copies sold, Earl came out with his book. So he was the first guy in bluegrass music to write a banjo instrumental that included chimes. And that was in 1953 with Sunny Mountain Chimes. And a few months later, Foggy Mountain Chimes came out, Earl Scruggs. And so he was listening to a 14-year-old Sonny Osborne in 1953. He played with Bill Monroe at 14, of course, was on the Opry at 14. They were the first bluegrass band to ever play at a college campus. In 1960, they played Antioch College, which bringing bluegrass music to a educational place hadn't really been done yet, and that opened up a whole new venue for bluegrass acts to get to play at colleges. In 1973, they played the White House, and they opened for Merle Haggard for about a year. Of course, they had the state song with Rocky Top that sold 85,000 copies in the first 7 days. He loved to mention that. And he loved to mention that he got to go to the mailbox every morning and check on his royalty checks. They also had Kentucky state song, which that's where he was born. I would like to also mention how he helped me. I'll try not to get emotional about this, but when I was about 19 years old, of course I've loved their music my entire life, but we were talking about his brother Bobby and how one thing that Bobby did great was he stayed out of Sonny's way when he was playing, and Sonny stayed out of Bobby's way when he was singing. And if Sonny was really on a roll at the end of a break, he would kind of stay back from the microphone and see where it went before he jumped back in right before the branch broke on the tree, you know. And we were talking about how awesome Bobby is at that. And I said, I wish I'd have been born 30 or 40 years earlier to get to play with Bobby. And he said, well, he still plays the Opry on Saturday nights. You know, I could probably get you a gig with him, as if that wasn't a really big deal. And he said, you'd have to wear a suit, though. And I said, well, I think I can handle that. And a couple months later, I got a text on a Wednesday evening from Bobby wanting to know what I was doing that Saturday, that he had an open Opry spot if I wanted to come play. And I, of course, took him up on it. And I've gotten to play the Opry several times since then with Bobby, and it's been a real treat. And we actually, Sonny and I started a banjo company together, Craco Banjos. And he started it, and I had the first one and had kind of taken it out to some shows and played it. And the first one was just a banjo he had built out of his garage and out of just parts. And it had a Gibson neck in it. And before I left the house, he said, put some tape over that where it says Gibson. I've sold enough banjos for Gibson. And so I did, and I wrote the name Craco on it, which was the little, for those of you that don't know, Sonny, the little demon that lived in his banjo that caused all the tuning problems. That's a whole nother story that I won't get into. But I took that to the first show, and there was, when I got done, there was three or four people there, banjo players standing there wanting to know where they could buy a Craco banjo. So I quickly called Sonny and told him, you know, there's a market for this. And he assembled a team to start building these banjos. And after about the third one sold, he called me and he said, how would you like to be half owners in this banjo company? And I said, well, that'd be great, but I just graduated college and have $12 in my banking account. So I don't know how I'm going to invest in a banjo company right now. And he said, your investment will be just you playing one. And he gave me half owners in this banjo company at 20 years old. something I could have never afforded. And he also gave me lessons for the last 8 years of his life that everything from music to the music business to lessons in life, and he never charged me a penny for any of that. And you know, a lot of people make their living doing lessons, and it was incredibly kind for him to give me a career, basically, free of charge. So I'd like to thank you. On behalf of the Osborne family and myself, it's the greatest honor of my life to get to accept this award for him. So I know he's smiling somewhere.
The museum's founder, Jack Canine, and I occasionally had a difference of opinion. One of them was many years ago when we had a Hall of Fame inductee who was deceased and was not represented at the Hall of Fame dinner. And he said, "We never want that to happen again." I said, "Well, why not? They deserve to be in the Hall of Fame, and they should be in the Hall of Fame." So what you're about to experience is Jack said along the way, you know, yeah, we should honor the people who should be in the Hall of Fame, and we came to a meeting of minds. So tonight we're honoring a group. It's called the Banjo Kings. If you're a four-string banjo player, they set a new standard in ensemble playing for between two banjos and three banjos. And anybody who plays the four-string banjo with another banjo player today has a debt of thanks to owe to the Banjo Kings, myself included. So I am thrilled that even though they are long gone and their family is nowhere to be found, we're able tonight to honor the Banjo Kings.
Since the infancy of the recording industry in the early 20th century, when the record-buying public demanded a certain type of music, record companies responded. As early jazz recordings by stars such as Duke Ellington, Paul Whiteman, and Louis Armstrong proved both popular and profitable, record companies, in an attempt to make their roster of artists appear larger, began creating new bands out of thin air made up of existing studio musicians. With countless records being released under pseudonyms to fit the musical genre, it was as a result of this dubious business practice that two Hollywood-based musicians named Dick Roberts and Luther Red Roundtree came forever to be known as the Banjo Kings, and banjo history was changed forever. Born in 1897, Dick Roberts grew up in the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia, surrounded by music. After his parents divorced, he moved to Denver, where he began the study of various stringed and reed instruments, while excelling on guitar, saxophone, and Hawaiian guitar, becoming a professional while still in his teens. It was the response to his tenor banjo solos broadcast over KOA radio that opened Hollywood's doors in 1933. Quickly becoming one of the busiest musicians in town, Roberts provided the soundtrack for the 1936 film Banjo on My Knee while doing a myriad of record and nightclub dates along with radio and early television broadcasts. Luther Red Roundtree was born in Mount Pleasant, Texas in 1905. After playing guitar as a youngster with his hoedown fiddling father, Roundtree began playing plectrum banjo professionally in 1923. During the 1930s, he toured with Blue Steel and his orchestra, making nearly 20 RCA Victor records with the group before lighting in Memphis, where he hosted his own radio program. Later, Rountree moved to Hollywood in 1940, where the versatile musician seamlessly segued from comedic roles with Spike Jonze and his City Slickers to countless radio shows and record dates. Unbeknownst to them, by the early 1950s, a perfect banjo storm was brewing for Roberts and Rountree. America was in the throes of a nostalgia boom, and the public was craving banjo records. Reasoning that two banjos were better than one, in 1951, the Good Time Jazz label of Vogue Records paired Dick Roberts and Red Rountree in their first recording, simply entitled Banjo Kings. The name stuck, and when the duo brought down the house in front of an audience of 7,000 at the Dixieland Jazz Jubilee held at the Shrine Auditorium in Los Angeles in 1951, a new era of banjo royalty commenced. It wasn't just nostalgia which endeared the pair to the public. The Banjo Kings were really good. Performing a repertoire of time-honored banjo favorites, played with just enough of a modern flair to sound decidedly uncorny, Robert's shimmering tenor solo style, paired with Rountree's driving plectrum rhythm, would have been enough to satisfy any banjo fan. But when the duo launched into the scintillating harmonized duets for which they became famous, a new standard in four-string banjo ensemble playing was established, which British critic Charles Wilford described as true banjo style brought to the highest pitch of technical perfection. After the Banjo King's reign, Dick Roberts performed regularly with the Disney-based Firehouse 5 Plus 2 Dixieland Band, while Red Rountree went on to do national radio and television shows with Dinah Shore, Burns and Allen, and Gene Autry, in addition to recording sessions which included Elvis Presley's Love Me Tender. In 1953, Good Time Jazz producer Lester Koenig prophetically wrote, "If there is ever a banjo Hall of Fame, Roberts and Rountree will certainly take their places among the greats of the past, while long being remembered as setting a very high standard for all banjoists of the future." Although they fulfilled many and varied musical roles during their careers, living to see their trademark band name appropriated by many other banjo groups through a unique musical partnership in which the sum truly exceeded its parts, Dick Roberts and Red Rountree will always be remembered as the Banjo Kings.
Hello. One of the great things about music is that it can live on past your lifetime. You can record it, you can write it, you can inspire young players to play it. The Banjo Kings did all of those things for us. Tonight, thankfully, because Dick Roberts was such a good musician, he left behind four sheets of music that we've graciously provided to our backup band. It's pretty good when you get a backup band of two new Hall of Fame members playing the instruments they're not being inducted for.
That's a good point.
So Tyler and I sat down and did our best to decipher the music, and we're going to do our best with the help of Randy Morris and Don Vappy to give you a little taste of the Banjo Kings 2022 style. Got it?
Are you ready, guys?
Yep.
Thank you. John Deppen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Tyler.
Yeah, nice.
That was fun, huh? Anybody want to take a chart? Yeah, that'd be great. Thanks. We talked about little surprises, and now for something completely different, as Monty Python would say. We're just going to take a break from the Hall of Fame presentations and do something really special. If you're a banjo player or a banjo collector, the name Akira Samura would mean something to you. Akira Samura lived in Tokyo, Japan. He lives in Tokyo, Japan. He amassed the largest collection of banjos in the world. When you look at our museum in Oklahoma City, he had even more banjos than we have there at one time in a private collection. Not too long ago, just a couple of months ago, Akira Samura contacted me and said, I've got a banjo, and my English is better than his, but I'm not going to use the accent here. But he said, I have a banjo that I think you'd like to have in the museum. As banjo players, if you're a player at all, especially four-string world, the company Bacon & Day, or B&D, or the Bacon Banjo Company, is one of the makers that made some of the best banjos that were ever made and ever will be made. Their namesake was a man named Frederick Bacon. Frederick Bacon was a guy who played what we call classic five-string banjo. It was played with fingers, similar to bluegrass, but it wasn't played with picks. And they would play popular tunes of the day back in the turn of the last century, and or marches and classic pieces. Frederick Bacon was a superstar of his day and basically a celebrity endorser for the Bacon Banjo Company. He really didn't build them or design them, but he went out there and promoted them. And among banjo players in those days, he was considered one of the finest that ever lived. Akira Samura called and says, I have Frederick Bacon's Bacon Banjo. The banjo that was made by his company for him. It embodies everything that Bacon could ever possibly put into a banjo. Gold plating, engraving, carving, rhinestones anywhere you look. And I don't tell the board of directors anything, but I strongly plead to our board of directors, this is a banjo that we should have in the museum, and they agreed. And through a wonderful set of circumstances, the American Banjo Museum is now the steward of Fred Bacon's Bacon Banjo. And to demonstrate that banjo for you tonight, playing in the classic style, is a Hall of Fame member, usually playing plectrum banjo, tonight playing Fred Bacon's Bacon in the classic style. Please welcome Debbie Schreier. Thank you.
It's so nice to bring these treasures of American history back to America. Thanks for showing everyone what the banjo can do. Debbie Schreier, thank you again. When I was young and all I wanted to do was play the four-string tenor banjo and play 5'2", Ain't She Sweet, and Bye Bye Blues, I hung around a music store that specialized in bluegrass music. And they said, you know, there's a banjo player you'd probably like, but he plays five-string banjo. I said, hey, he plays five-string banjo. I couldn't possibly like him. And then they gave me an album called A Banjo Sandwich by Alan Mundy. And changed my mind about what the banjo can do and the fact that there weren't all these brick walls between different styles. And when I think about that, I'm really honored to say tonight we honor Alan Mundy. If you don't know Alan, please take a look at his video here and we'll get a chance to hear him play and show you what influenced me so much. Thank you.
In the world of bluegrass, the role and perception of the five-string banjo is in a constant state of evolution, from those early pioneers who inspired Earl Scruggs to modern-day banjo masters. Each successive generation has learned from and built upon the foundations laid by their predecessors. While firmly rooted in bluegrass traditions, innovative banjo artist Alan Mundy has rightfully taken his place as a leading architect of the musical bridge between the past and present, becoming one of the most influential five-string banjo players in history. Born in Norman, Oklahoma in 1946, the musical journey of Alan Mundy was kick-started when his brother returned from naval service with a cheap guitar and a record on how to play it. Intrigued by the instrument, as well as the revival in folk music which was in the air during the 1960s, Mundy, primarily teaching himself from Pete Seeger's book, quickly progressed from the guitar to the five-string banjo. Stoked at hearing Flatten Scruggs' Foggy Mountain Banjo LP, Alan's passion for bluegrass was ignited, and his future musical direction became clear. From his first band, the East Ridge Ramblers, formed in 1965, Mundy picked his way through the University of Oklahoma, meeting several musicians who would greatly impact his future along the way. Slim Ritchie, who sold Alan his first banjo, would ultimately go on to produce several of his solo recording projects, as well as band LPs and CDs. Banjoist Ed Shelton of the Stone Mountain Boys became Mundy's biggest inspiration, encouraging him to develop the skill of playing fiddle tunes note for note on the banjo. Guitarist Wayne Stewart coaxed Alan to move to Kentucky after graduation to join him and mandolinist Sam Bush in the formation of a new band called Poor Richard's Almanac. Yet with all of these early collaborators, it would be legendary fiddle player Byron Burline who would accompany Mundy from his humble beginnings as a substitute banjoist with the Stone Mountain Boys to mainstream recording success. After 2 years of paying his dues, touring with the bluegrass icon Jimmy Martin and his band, the Sunny Mountain Boys, in September of 1971, Alan received a call from Byron Burline inviting him to come to California and join a new group called the Country Gazette. Approaching bluegrass with a decidedly pop feel, Country Gazette was perceived by United Artists executives as a country rock band and signed to a national recording contract. Beginning with their 1972 LP release, A Trader in Our Midst, Country Gazette began introducing a more contemporary look and feel to the traditional bluegrass stereotype, and by design, attracted a new and broader audience to the music in the process. The original members of Country Gazette went on to record three more LPs before other opportunities saw the group's personnel change over the years. With more band and solo recording projects to follow, Alan Mundy remained at the helm of Country Gazette up to and including the time he was recruited by Southern Plains College in Texas to serve as an associate professor in the school's groundbreaking commercial music program. During the nearly 20 years of teaching bluegrass technique and history that followed, Mundy, sharing the priceless lessons he learned as part of his own performance career, motivated countless aspiring musicians by stressing the importance of creating music over the mechanics of their instrument or the logistics of making a living. As one of bluegrass music's premier banjo players with a unique and readily identifiable sound and style, Mundy has been, as Eddie Adcock put it, an influence for modernity within tradition, constantly pushing himself, his colleagues, and his students to perform at the highest level of innovation and musicality. While modestly avoiding the reality of the contributions he has made to the world of the banjo and bluegrass, Alan Mundy prefers to think of himself as a student, always looking for those magic notes that reflect both his own music as well as the musical genre which he helped to define.
And with that, we'd like to welcome to the stage one of the humblest, nicest guys I've ever met, and a great musician, Alan Mundy.
These get heavier every year, Alan. On behalf of the American Banjo Museum, the board of directors, employees, and all the banjo players everywhere, congratulations and welcome to the Hall of Fame.
Thank you so very much. Pose for a picture.
Oh!
Thank you. I'm going to have to get at this. I'd like to thank everybody here, also the American Banjo Museum, the board of directors, the Hall of Fame electors, museum staff and volunteers, and just, this is no secret, but life is a collaboration, and certainly playing music is too, and I'll just quickly go through. My parents were not musicians, and in some ways didn't care very much about music in a sense, but they didn't mind that I did, and never stopped me from doing it, which is pretty good for parents, I think, is not get in your way. As was mentioned in the bit here, my oldest brother Mike brought home a guitar and sort of turned me on to it, and as he left it and went off to college, my other brother Jeffrey played guitar a little bit, but he had friends that played guitar. This is all when he was in high school and I was probably in junior high, and that was a big help. Just to have people around that played any at all, it was a thrill. When Jimmy Stradiger came over and played my guitar, which I knew was not a very good guitar, but he made it sound wonderful, and that was really important. And my sister was a big help, and I'd like to mention my cousins are here tonight, and want to thank them for, you know, their dad had a recording studio in Norman, Oklahoma at one time. And just as a pre-school kid, I would go hang out up there, and he had a piano. And I mean, this is really dumb in a way, but it's the kind of things that make a difference when you're a kid. Is I knew I'd seen people play piano on TV, certainly, and I knew they put their hands out and they move their fingers along the keys and they play it. So I sat at the piano one day and I put my fingers down and I looked and I realized, oh, they know where to put them. You know, and that's, you know, a revelation for a kid to know, oh, you have to learn how to do something. You know, you can't just fool around, you have to be trained to do it. So that was a big help, and that was my cousin's dad, Uncle Henry. And I'd like to also thank family members, my daughter Rachel, who put up with me being gone so much as a career musician. Her mother, Ann Solomon, was a put up with a lot till she couldn't put up with anymore. So I'd like to thank my wife, Kitty Ledbetter, for putting up with me here late in life, and to all my musical partners, including Bill Honker and Elliot Rogers, that were here, and to my long-gone musical partners, which have been mentioned, Byron Berline, Joe Carr, Roland White. I played music with them for many, many years, and they were a great, great help to me. And I've just got a few more. Especially like to thank David Michael Slim Ritchie, who was pictured in the he had a, when I got my brother's guitar and I looked for a music store to go take music lessons, and I looked in the Yellow Pages, the closest one was Mike Ritchie's Guitar Center, which was this character you saw up here, and I was buddies with him the whole rest of his life, and still am throughout my life. I'd like to thank Gary Price, who's a local Oklahoma banjo player who got me started at the very, very beginning. He showed me a few little things. And Eddie Shelton, who was in the video here, was my banjo mentor. He, I met him through Byron, and he was a great, great help to me. And I'd like to thank all the many great players I've listened to and learned from over the years, including Sonny Osborne, who I got to know later in my life and in his life also, and was a great inspiration. And so with that, I'd like to say thank you very much and good night. Thank you.
You notice he turned around and got the banjo. I had my eye on it. When I was a kid, I lived in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, and was playing banjo, and names started to pop up that turned into be icons. Hopefully, you know, I could play like that. Someday I'd meet these people. One of those people was a guy in Orlando, Florida. His name kept popping up in magazines as a piano player, a trumpet player, and a banjo player. His name is Randy Morris. And I sat there and said, well, you know, someday I'll meet Randy Morris. I met him in Stone Mountain, Georgia, back in the late 1970s. And we've been friends ever since. And I remember in Rock Crusher Canyon, which was if you can look this up, it was a place I used to manage and put shows together. Even though I lived in Orlando for about 8 years, I never actually worked with Randy until Rock Crusher Canyon. But we had a great time doing that. And I'll tell you something, you will never meet a more sincere musician who loves music for the sake of music than Randy Morris. And if you don't believe me, watch the story.
Since the beginning of the four-string banjo's comeback during the nostalgia boom of the 1960s and 70s, the amazing multi-instrumentalist Randy Morris has been omnipresent, both documenting and preserving the music and musicians of the past while being an essential cog in the establishment of internationally revered performance venues as well as exciting new musical standards in classic jazz and ragtime. Born and raised in the show business mecca of Los Angeles, after being inspired by an LP record by banjoist Jad Paul, Randy and his childhood friend Chris Robert formed their own banjo duo called the Banjo Maniacs. From that humble beginning, Morris forged a lifelong love affair with the tenor banjo, growing to become a passionate student and player of the instrument, as well as an authority on the musicians, bands, and recordings that brought and kept the banjo in the public's eye from the 1920s to the present day. A love for Dixieland and early jazz, which was nurtured by seeing the likes of Louis Armstrong, Spike Jones, and Mickey Finn performing at Disneyland, ultimately led to Morris developing lasting friendships with iconic performers such as Hubie Blake, Freddie Morgan, and other Spike Jones alumni, as well as Fred Mickey Finn himself.
Will somebody pick up the pizzas?
Coming to the realization that he liked the piano as much as the banjo, Randy taught himself both instruments well enough to be playing professionally at various Shakey's pizza parlors around Los Angeles while still in high school. In 1971, Morris made a life-changing move to Orlando, Florida, just in time to be part of the opening day of the new Walt Disney World Resort. Starting out playing piano at Coke Corner, Randy, now playing piano, banjo, and trumpet, became one of the busiest musicians on Disney's property. Through a half-century association with Disney, Morris worked with many different groups and shows, including the Banjo Kings, the Diamond Horseshoe Jamboree, Pat Terry and Son, the Pioneer Hall Players, the Hoop-Dee-Doo Review, and the Riverboat Rascals.
Why don't we sing some of the old frog songs?
In 1990, Randy was tapped to provide the banjo soundtrack for the Muppets at Walt Disney World television special, and, on the occasion of Disney World's 50th anniversary in 21, reprised his role, again playing piano in what is now called Casey's Corner. Meanwhile, in 1974 in downtown Orlando, entrepreneur and jazz trumpet player Bob Snow had opened the largest nightclub in the state called Rosie O'Grady's. With its 1920s vibe attracting turnaway business and Disney being primarily a daytime attraction, Randy moonlighted with Rosie O'Grady's Good Time Jazz Band, ultimately becoming the band's leader. Add to the mix gigs at Universal Studios, SeaWorld, Circus World, the Delta Queen, Mississippi Queen, and American Queen Riverboats, as well as appearing in the theatrical show Satchmo and performing at countless jazz festivals and cruises as part of the Bill Allred Classic Jazz Band, Wally's Warehouse Waifs, and many other bands, it becomes clear that Randy Morris was and is one of the most in-demand musicians in the world of ragtime and traditional jazz. Parallel to his performing career, Randy is a lifelong avid collector and archivist of anything related to ragtime, early jazz, and banjo history. His massive collection of vintage recordings, phonographs, instruments, and ephemera has rescued and preserved for future generations many treasures which, without his help, might have been lost forever. Of particular interest is Randy's passion for documenting the legacy of the comic genius band leader Spike Jonze, along with the steady stream of banjo players and musicians who performed through the years with his band, Spike Jonze and the City Slickers. To say that he is a gifted musician and unique individual is understatement in its purest form. As one of those rare people whose passions in life become their career, Randy Morris has lived for his music. The music of the past, which he preserves, the music of the present, which he creates, and the unlimited possibilities associated with the music of the future.
As our performers and honorees come to the stage, I'd like to take a second to acknowledge Lucas Ross. He is the guy who is responsible for all this wonderful editing, especially the great finale that you just saw. We take the stories, I write them, I give them the pictures, and Lucas puts them all together. And it's not only a burden off of me, but I know that as this thing goes into the future, that these stories are going to be told right. So thank you, Lucas. You've done a great job. And now to give you a sample of what inspired me to move to Orlando, please welcome our 2016 Hall of Fame inductee, Pat Terry Jr., and our newest inductee, 22 inductee, Mr. Randy Morris.
Hi.
Hello. Well, first of all, thank you so much to Johnny Barr and to everybody involved in putting that thing together. Oh my gosh, that was so much fun. And the thing is, music, entertainment, art, it is fun. It is fun. Sometimes it's serious, sometimes it's dark, but a lot of times it's fun. Especially banjos. And that's why we like them so much. We are going to play one of the most popular four-string songs that was mentioned here earlier. It's been played to death, but that doesn't matter because it's still a good song and we still like it and it's still really neat on the banjo. So Pat Terry Jr. is being featured on this because it's his and his dad's arrangement. I was so fortunate to meet them 51 years ago at Disneyland and to learn things from them. His dad showed me things that I didn't know about the banjo at the time. Of course, I was only 18 years old, so I had stuff to learn. I'm still learning. Isn't that another thing about music that's wonderful? There's so much you can learn. It doesn't matter where you're at. Just keep doing it. It's enjoyable. And what is the name of this song again, sir?
Let me think. Bye Bye Blues?
Bye Bye Blues.
You ever hear that one?
That sounds good to me. All right. You got it, right?
Randy Morris and Pat Terry Jr.
Thank you. Should I leave now?
Yeah, you got to start getting in everybody's car out of the garage here soon. Oh. So without further ado, on behalf of the Board of Directors, the Hall of Fame members, and all the members of the American Banjo Museum, we'd like to induct you into the Hall of Fame.
Thank you, sir.
Randy Morris.
Can I speak? We got
Oh, put that there.
I already spoke, so this will be very, very short. But the banjo, I have always loved. I loved the five-string banjo even when I was a little kid. My earliest banjo recording that I have restored is from 1897. I was friends with Freddie Morgan. Anybody knows who Spike Jonze is and has seen Freddie Morgan? He was so incredibly funny. And he was an excellent banjo player. But he actually was so great at comedy, he says, yeah, I'm going to go with that. But I'm not going to give up the banjo. I have a recording of Freddie Morgan playing the Rhapsody in Blue as a solo on the tenor banjo. So he was really, really good. So that's enough of me, because all I want to say to you is this is wonderful to have the Banjo Museum. It's wonderful to have you support and participate in it. And we will keep doing this as long as we are going. Thank you.
Okay. The final inductee of the evening has got a big job ahead of him the way I look at it, but I know he can do it. Don Vappy is a true jazz musician. He's a true musician who plays jazz, and he has devoted that energy in many, many ways to the banjo. And in a path like that, both jazz and the banjo can't help but be better off. So for those of you who are meeting Don Vappy for the first time, you are in for a real treat. If you've never met Don, watch his story, and then you will get a chance to hear him play. Don Vappy.
In the world of the tenor banjo, it is a rarity when a contemporary artist is able to bring a new, unique, and instantly recognizable sound and style to the instrument which had its heyday a century ago and has constantly been redefined and reinvented in the years since. Yet, with innate talent coupled with a sincere desire to preserve the past via a living culture, New Orleans banjo master Don Vappy has done just that. Born in 1956, Don Vappy can barely remember a time in life when he did not want to be a musician. A product of the unique Creole heritage of New Orleans, which produced early jazz greats such as Jelly Roll Morton and King Oliver, Vappy's own proud musical lineage includes his great uncles, Papa John and Willie Kaiser Joseph, both of whom were among the Crescent City's earliest jazz musicians. At the age of 6, Don began the piano lessons, which would prove to be the musical foundation for the trumpet, baritone horn, bass, and guitar which were to follow. Surrounded by the diverse musical opportunities that New Orleans had to offer in the 1970s, Vappy gave pop music a try, playing bass guitar in a top 40 band called Track One, prior to coming to the realization that it was jazz music which was his heritage and musical destiny. Mentored by many of the musicians whose lives exemplified Creole cultural traditions, Vappy, playing both guitar and bass, quickly made a name for himself in New Orleans jazz circles. Although he was aware of the racial baggage connected to the banjo, Don found the instrument to have a very musical sound, and in the mid-1980s, his banjo life began. Initially playing the instrument in the Chicago style and later switching to traditional tenor tuning, the banjo kick-started Vappy's career, seeing him become one of the busiest banjo players in town and ultimately landing a regular gig as part of the famous Preservation Hall Jazz Band. Immersed in the rhythmic vibe that helped define the city's culture, the outspoken and independent Vappy found a passion in playing music that lived well beyond the typical Dixieland repertoire demanded by the New Orleans tourist trade. In addition to breathing new life into the music of his jazz predecessors, Vappy's solo work, along with performances by his own Creole jazz serenaders, creatively blend vintage jazz stylistic ingredients with refreshing musical and rhythmic modes, often rooted in Creole and Caribbean cultures. The result is a rush of the vibrant energy already embedded in the music that affects both audiences and musicians alike. Throughout his career, Vappy's commitment to New Orleans music and culture has been documented in many recording and film projects. As audio bookends, the 1986 vinyl LP, Papa Don's New Orleans Jazz Band, anchored the beginning of a prolific recording career, which recently saw his 2020 CD release, The Blue Book of Storyville, named the best jazz record of the year by the London Times. In 2006, Don and wife Millie co-produced American Creole, New Orleans Reunion, a PBS documentary which took viewers to the front lines of a devastated city's cultural rebirth after Hurricane Katrina.
When the music come back, everybody's gonna come back.
While they tried, the transparency and genuineness of Don Vappy's music could not be contained within the confines of New Orleans. As one of the city's de facto musical ambassadors, in addition to the countless concerts and festival appearances that take him literally around the world, Vappy appears frequently with jazz trumpeter Wynton Marsalis as part of the Jazz from Lincoln Center programs. Further national recognition came his way in 2021 when Vappy became the recipient of the prestigious Steve Martin Banjo Prize.
What's the matter now? Hey, what's the matter now?
Whether providing the rhythmic pulse of a jazz band or effortlessly breezing through a suite of Harry Reeser compositions in front of a symphony orchestra, Don Vappy's one-of-a-kind sound and style present the tenor banjo with both musicality and distinction. As did his mentors who came before him, Vappy keeps traditions alive and current so that the torch can be passed. As he says, we can only conserve and respect our past by living our culture and honoring the spirit of our traditions.
And we'd like to give you a sample of what you've just heard about live as we welcome our new inductee Don Vappy, clarinetist Thomas Fisher, and bassist Richard Moten to the American Banjo Museum Hall of Fame stage. Welcome, guys.
Like a real festival, you know? I'm usually not, but I'm really nervous right now. Some great music I've heard sitting there, and I feel like I have a special connection with Alan Monday because we got each other's letter for the Steve Martin Prize, you know. I said, I think y'all made a mistake, man. It's like, yeah, it's, you know. Anyway, I also didn't know what to play. So I just thought I'll play something that, this is an old song. It's the Tin Roof Blues, you may know. It's a medley of the Tin Roof Blues and another song I learned called the Creole Blues. My family, my grandmother and all, they all spoke Creole French, but for whatever reasons in New Orleans, you know, kind of like now in a bit, you know, it's like, no, you got to speak English. You know, it's like, it was discouraged. And I thought, they didn't really understand the value of it until World War II, when the Louisiana troops could communicate with the French resistance. That's when it became okay. But that was after me, so before me. So I just thought these Creole songs are just kind of dying away. Nobody's doing them. And one of my mentors was the great Danny Barker. And anyway, let me just play. I talk when I get nervous. He knows. Jolie fille, vous pourquoi vous pas viens ici? Jolie fille, pourquoi vous pas viens ici? Vous connaissez l'aimez-vous, m'aurez-vous pour moi, chérie? Mais que jolie fille dans cette maison. Mais que jolie fille dans cette maison. Si vous croyez moi, Esther, je sais. Je sais bien attendre. Thank you.
I don't know.
What are you, union scale?
What kind of gig is this?
Did you want to play another one?
No. I mean,
does everybody want to hear another one? It's up to you. Did you do that one you did last night, that Como Se Va? Yeah. That's why she didn't come, isn't it?
Well, yeah, probably.
Johnny, can they do another one? Johnny, can they do another one? Yeah, we got money in the budget.
Well, he knows it. He played it once.
And
I'll probably. But anyway, it was. I should have talked to
him. Here, you want to do your touch ID?
Yeah, I could do that. It's my fingerprint. It's not working. Oh, there it is. So.
Does this way or this way?
That way. Because you want to. Okay, I didn't know. You know, we played in Chestertown, Maryland, what, last week, was it?
2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago, and we had to rent cars because we flew to Baltimore. Tom was driving, I was driving. Tom spent 20 minutes trying to figure out how to start his car. Because it's like the key fob, you know, and you got to put your foot on and press it. He's like, man, I and then it turns out it was a hybrid, so it was ready. It just wasn't making any noise. I don't hear anything. It's just, it says vehicle ready to drive. Go. Yeah. I hope I don't mess this up. This is one of the songs off my album I wrote. It's called The Color of Creole. And it's another one of those things, you know, because sometimes, well, I'm just going to play it. I don't need to talk about it. Just play it. Good luck.
Thank you.
really needed that string.
Don Vappy. On behalf of the American Banjo Museum, the Board of Directors, past Hall of Fame members, and the members of the museum, congratulations and welcome to the Hall of Fame. Don Vappy.
I didn't think about having to say anything, but I'm a good bold person. So anyway, no, I wanted to thank. I can say this without looking at my phone. There's people in New Orleans that I never got to really know that were inspirational, and it was kind of through their families. Like, I got to play with George French and Bob French, and their father was Albert French, the banjo player. And then there was this guy, George Gaynor. People pronounce it like Guisnon or something, but it's Gaynor. That's, you know, crazy French spellings and stuff. And Danny Barker. I was on a concert with Wynton, and Danny, I was playing bass. It was at the Mahalia Jackson Theater, and it was a great time. I got to play with Ruby Braff and Howard Alden and Ellis and all, and I was playing bass, and it was like, wow, you know. So we had the rehearsal for the New Orleans section, and Danny was sitting in front of me, and when we took a break, I said, "Hey, Danny, that's a nice banjo." He said, "Yeah, yeah, here, play it." I said, "Well, I don't." He said, "Play it." I said, okay, I'm playing. So I picked it up and played it, and he kept looking at me saying, like, "What you think, huh? What you think? You know, that's an old people New Orleans thing. What you think, huh? 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 What you think about that?" So I can't help but every time I'm in a situation that's something like this, it's like Danny was telling me to, because he actually colored his banjo head a different color because of those racial stereotypes and the idea of the banjo belonging to slavery and all that, which is not true. But, you know, when he just kept looking at me, and it's like he was saying, "You can take this somewhere else." So I don't know if that was, maybe that's him inside of me not letting me know it's him trying to do stuff. But I really try to make my hometown people, my New Orleanians, proud of the instrument, because it is a evolution of the African goni or the halam, you know. And anyway, when I picked it up, I just thought it sounded more funky than a muted guitar, you know, like, you know, Earth, Wind, and Fire. The banjo is great for that. You don't have to mute it, nothing. It's just percussive power. But yeah, so I wish my mother and father were alive to see this, because my mom, I was always into music, and my dad said, "You need something to fall back on." She said, "Leave the boy alone. He's got to go through that." And see, it was my mom's family, Papa John Joseph and Willie Kaiser Joseph and Nelson. Nelson and Willie, I think, had the barbershop. Their barbershop was across the street from Buddy Bolden in the late 1800s, where Buddy Bolden lived. So anyway, I also have to thank Richard, a bass player. He's my cousin. His mom. Yeah, bro, your mama gave me piano lessons. That was the lady who did it. And I didn't keep up, but I did get a puppy out of the deal. But it was a real good foundation for music, and I wish Marie was alive to see us playing together too. So I don't know what else to say, y'all. This is just beyond what I thought it was ever going to happen with me playing a banjo. So thank you very much. I appreciate this.
Oh, shit.
Well, we are getting to the end of the program. We have a little housekeeping announcement. If you came over on the bus from the hotel, you are not going out the same way you came in. When you go down the elevator, you're going to make a right. You're going to go to the east. You will be guided by Margie or Eric or somebody who looks official and make your way through the Colcord Hotel and get on the bus, which will take you to the Renaissance Hotel. And if that ain't confusing enough, ask Margie on the way out, but no, please make sure to do that. We really need to thank you all for being here. You've been a lovely audience, but before we're done, I want to introduce Doug Parsons one more time with a one more special award for the evening.
Thanks, Shawna. You guys did a great job tonight. Let's give everybody and the staff. Thank you. I hope everybody's had a great time tonight. All year long we plan this event, and every year it gets better and better and better. The nominees and the people that were elected this year, as Randy says, they were abdicated or indicted or something. And but congratulations to all of you. You've honored us with your presence. You've honored us with your place in the Hall of Fame. So give them one more big hand. Every year, I've knew Jack for a lot of years, Jack Canine, and he always did a thing called the Jack Canine Award, where he took somebody or took advice from somebody that actually made a difference in the banjo world, made a difference in the banjo museum, or made a difference in some child's lives in the banjo. The individual, and I, as the chairman of the board, I get suggestions all over, all year round, and I have to pick somebody for this. And this year, it was a great honor, and the individual that we picked has spent many, many years on this museum. In this museum. He was one of the original founders of the Museum Hall of Fame. He's one of the original board members of the Hall of Fame in Guthrie, Oklahoma. Every year they sponsor things. Every year he's always there no matter what we need. I think he's been our vice president for 20 years. So I'd like to honor Lester Cowden.
Thank you so very much. I am absolutely speechless, did not expect this. And I remember when the Banjo Museum started, I always knew it would go somewhere. I didn't know where, but when we moved from Guthrie to Oklahoma City, it was clear it was going to be a great institution. And I am so proud to be a part of it. And so thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you, Doug, for all the work you did and have done and continue to do. And Johnny, thank you so much. Without you, this museum would not be what it is today. And the staff that has so loyally held us together. So thank you all, and thank you very much. I certainly deeply appreciate it. Take care.
Oh my God.
We'll deal with it.
Wow. Look out there. There you go.
Okay, thank you. I can tell you I'm not as what I was many, many years ago when it started. I'm up in my 80s. I'm closer to 90 now than 80, and I started playing in 1994, so thank you, Doug, for carrying it down for me. It is heavy.
And with that, we conclude tonight's program. Thank you. Now, I want to ask you guys if you enjoyed Don Vappy, if you enjoyed Randy Morris, Pat Terry Jr., if you enjoyed Ainsley Porchak and Lincoln Hensley, and if you what's that? I was getting to Alan Mundy. I'm doing alphabetical in reverse, starting with, Alan Mundy and his trio, and Tyler Jackson and myself. On behalf of all of the artists that performed tonight, you were a lovely audience. Tomorrow we're going to do it all over again with the Bricktown Banjo Bash. All of the artists you saw today will be performing during the day, starting at noon, going to 8 o'clock. And then tomorrow night, Randy Morris and I are going to relive our Shakey's Pizza Parlor roots into a sing-along party at the museum to close off the weekend. So if you haven't had enough banjo yet, and I can't imagine that's possible, but if you haven't had enough banjo yet, we've got one more day. Thank you for being here. Welcome to Oklahoma City. Good night, everybody.